I don't believe the Anunnaki were one race of aliens, right? You could say it was like a consortium, a bunch of different alien species. And what is alien? I don't like the word alien. You could call them extraterrestrial or intraterrestrial. I believe they've been here all along. It's not a function of whether or not these so-called aliens or extraterrestrials or intraterrestrials are here or not. They're always here. The only question is humanity in a cycle where we are allowed access through higher dimensional perspectives to be able to perceive them?
Welcome to the show, Robert Edward Grant. How you doing, Rob?
Such a pleasure to be here in your studio. Yes. What an amazing studio you've basically put together here. I'm like really blown away. It's state of the art.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate it, man. Yeah, I'm so psyched to have you here, man. We've been talking about this for a while.
I know.
So this is going to be a fairly epic conversation, I have a feeling. So last time you were on, our last episode did okay.
A million views. Probably closing. On all the platforms, it's got to be over a million.
Yeah, I think at this point, it's getting at least to a million in a month or two. Something like
just
that.
On YouTube, but don't you also post on all the other platforms?
Yeah. Like so Spotify, yeah. So over everything, over a million, no question. So people were really interested what you discovered in the Great Pyramid and what you're doing there. What I wanted to talk about in this episode, among other things, where I'm sure we're going to go off on many rabbit holes on this conversation. With the pyramid itself, there's so much mystery around the pyramids and what you discovered. Can you give a short description of what you discovered inside the King's Chamber?
So what we discovered, the first discovery that I made inside the King's Chamber of the Great Pyramid was the Alpha Omega on the rim of the sarcophagus. And then after that, my wife Susie actually found in 2020 a bull on the wall. And then my assistant, Eden, Viza, she basically found a bird up on the wall as well, that then I then saw another bird next to it. So we started seeing, all of us started seeing different patterns on the walls. And so it was really a collaborative effort. I was the first to see Alpha Omega, but now we found that there are many, many etchings on the walls, and they're all petroglyphs. And they're not done in the style of like what you would consider for ancient Egypt. And so, and they all overlap each other too. It's really kind of amazing. Some of the etchings are done in a 3D perspective. So it's a unique type of drawing that we only learned how to do in around the 15th century. And so they're very advanced from that perspective. But even then, we didn't use it the way that it's used here. So how in the heck did these end up? It's almost as if it was done in the future. How did these petroglyphs end up on the walls? And then we didn't know what the patterns were of the petroglyphs. We knew the Alpha Omega, and we knew that the bull and the cow that we found on the wall were related to that, because the Apis bull is the Alpha, and the Omega is the shape of the Hathor's hair, right?
I saw it.
And so that's very well known. But what we didn't know was the whole room, because we knew that there were petroglyphs all over the walls, and we knew that those same matching petroglyphs showed up in the Last Supper painting by Leonardo da Vinci. We knew that he spent three and a half years in Egypt, because he wrote about it, and he was surveying the great Mount Taurus that everybody in history thinks was actually a mountain in Armenia. Well, he spelled Armenia incorrectly, even for that time. He called it Armenia, and that was an encryption for an ermine, which is a weasel-looking animal. And he made a painting called The Lady with the Ermine. Right? The ermine is related to a magic order of hermetic wisdom that was called the Order of the Ermine.
Okay.
And this is the same little animal that they used to make the robes of kings and around the rim of a crown, you know, the fur that you see with little black dots on it. It's the tip of the tail that makes the black dots. So what we found was actually Da Vinci wasn't referring to Armenia. He was referring to the Egyptian mystery schools. He was referring to the great Mount Taurus is the great mountain of Ras Tau. Ras Tau is the original name of the Giza Plateau. It's Taurus backwards. And the original name of the Great Pyramid is Bull Mountain. So that's the hieroglyphics of it. In fact, you have two chevrons on top of each other that represent mountain. And then you have an Apis bull right next to it. That's the ancient symbol in hieroglyphics for the Great Pyramid.
So I want to ask. So yeah, I'm sure the Great Pyramid was named by some English explorer. So hey, you know what we're going to call this? A Great Pyramid.
They named it after Khufu. The story goes that there was a explorer from England who had gotten about £1 million in investment to go and try to figure out the treasure and find the treasure mm-hmm. in the Great Pyramid. Mm-hmm. Lots of people tried. Napoleon before him as well. Mm-hmm. And basically, he couldn't find anything. There was never anything found in the pyramid except for the sarcophagus, one stone box. It's not very interesting from a treasure perspective.
But that stone, by the way, that stone box is not an actual burial.
No, they never found any. There's never been anyone found in that thing.
Right. So they call it a sarcophagus, but it really is just a box.
Yeah. Essentially. No. It's just a stone box that nobody knows what the real purpose of it is or was. And it's not elaborate. Like, there's nothing that you could see on it. No one noticed the Alpha Omega on the rim until I noticed it in 2018. Mm-hmm. And now nobody really disputes that at all. It's there, right? How did it get there? People don't know. That's the thing. I remembered being there when it was put there. That's how I found it. And all week long, I'd been writing and drawing Alpha Omega in my notebook in 2018. And the night before I discovered an Alpha Omega under the Dome of the Rock, under the Al-Aqsa Mosque in mm-hmm. Jerusalem, mm-hmm. And I was there for I was having a state dinner that night with a bunch of my YPO CEO friends. Mm-hmm. And I was one of the hosts. So I said, I was the chapter chair at the time. And I said, I'm going to go deep into the cave. Let me find the bathroom. So I asked where the bathroom was, and there was a harpist there. It looked like a straight up Illuminati dinner. Mm-hmm. These long tables with these big candelabras.
Was it like crystal. Eyes Wide Shut?
It kind of was, yeah. They would put their car keys in this bowl. No, I mean, it was all guys. So that would have been a lot of sausage. But anyway.
It would have been definitely a sausage party.
The only woman in there, I think, was literally probably the harpist.
Okay.
It was a giant harp in the center of the room, too.
Okay.
So I kind of said, where's the bathroom? I got to go get ready for my speech, because we had like dignitaries there and mm-hmm. stuff, too. So I didn't go to the bathroom. I jumped the fence that said, do not enter, and I went deep into the cave, because mm-hmm. I knew that's where the Ark of the Covenant was supposed to have been hidden mm-hmm. for a long time. Mm-hmm. After the reign of Zedekiah, so mm-hmm. these names of the caves were originally Solomon's Quarry, because mm-hmm. it was what they built Solomon's Temple from, mm-hmm. and then it became Zedekiah's cave as well. So when King Nebuchadnezzar came and attacked Jerusalem in 589 BC, and that caused the first diaspora, right? The first diaspora. Basically, he destroyed the Temple of Solomon, and they took the Ark of the Covenant down to Zedekiah's cave. And it was hidden in there for a long time until apparently the Knights Templar took it out.
Right.
And took it somewhere else. Now, so that means it would have been in there for at least 1,000 years.
What is the Ark of the Covenant?
The Ark of the Covenant is in the Bible.
Yes.
So it's described in, if you know the story, the Bible wasn't really written until, you know, Moses, right? So yeah. Moses comes mm-hmm. along and he wrote the five books of Moses. Mm-hmm. And so those are the ones that you would know, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Leviticus, Genesis, right? These are the stories that we have, right, about, and Hebrews, and that we have about the people that had been taken into captivity. Remember, they were taken into captivity because of Joseph, right, was sold by his family. So you had Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, mm-hmm. right? And Jacob's other name was Israel. Mm-hmm. So he had 12 sons. And one of those sons, the youngest son, was a fellow by the name of Joseph. Joseph was favored of his father the most, and he got the coat of many colors, which is probably just rainbow consciousness, mm-hmm. right? And so his brothers despised him for it, and so they sold him off into slavery. When the Egyptian traders came along, they sold their younger brother off into slavery. So, of course, the father was upset, and for his whole life, they didn't see him again. So what happened to Joseph? Well, he was psychic and he had special abilities. And so he ended up like making his way. There's a story about him with Potiphar and Potiphar's wife. And then he becomes close with the Pharaoh. Mm-hmm. He becomes like this advisor to the Pharaoh. And the Pharaoh has a dream and he's able to interpret dreams, right? And so one of the interpretations was, we're going to have 7 years of feast and 7 years of famine. And so he told the Pharaoh, we have to make storage of all the grain, right? Because Egypt was always a breadbasket, mm-hmm. even for that time. And so because of that, when the famine came, Egypt became very rich because it had food to basically make it through. And all the surrounding countries, right, were desolate. They had no food. And so that's when his original family came back and was begging for food. effectively. And he found them a place there because he was very well esteemed by the Pharaoh. So from that point in time, the family of, you know, that was the progeny of Abraham ended up in Egypt and were taken, at least as far as the Bible story goes, into captivity. Mm-hmm. And over time, they just became slaves, you know. And so they when the next Pharaoh came that knew not Joseph, mm-hmm. that's when the people started to really suffer. And so then that went on for a few hundred years until Moses came along, right?
Right.
So this story was supposed to be, Abraham was supposed to be around 2200 BC, mm-hmm. right? And then you've got, you know, this period of time would have been somewhere around, you know, the time of Moses was probably around they think it's like 1500 BC, mm-hmm. right? So who knows if these timelines are even correct? You know, that it could be, it seems like that's kind of a really long time.
Well, let me ask you a question real quick. Abraham, because I know who Abraham is, obviously, and he's like the basis of the Abrahamic religions,
oh,
essentially.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you got three religions that basically.
Off of him, essentially. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So was he an avatar? Was he like a Jesus figure or a Buddha figure in any way, shape, or form? Because he, I mean, obviously spawned off three of the major world religions. So he was pretty important.
Oh, he was very important. There's mm-hmm. no doubt. I mean, right. He was supposed to have been from, you know, the Mesopotamia area, mm-hmm. right, the land of Ur. But he paid tithing. So his spiritual leader, he paid tithing to Melchizedek. Mm-hmm. So Melchizedek was, the word Melchizedek means Malik, or king. So if you know someone, like my partner's name is Vic Malik, my business partner, mm-hmm. Malik means king, right? And that's an old word that's been used, you know, it's mainly referring to people that are, you know, probably more of Muslim mm-hmm. orientation mm-hmm. And ethnicity. But it comes from the word Melik. Melik means king in Hebrew.
Okay.
So Malki Tzedek is like king or prince of peace. Prince of peace, prince of justice is another meaning for that. Mm-hmm. So Tzedek. So, and the place where they lived was in the land of Salem, mm-hmm. right? So the land of Salem was Jerusalem, right? So originally it was just called Salem. Mm-hmm. And the ruler of that land was Melchizedek. Mm-hmm. So Abraham was given, though, this, you know, blessing that his wife Sarah, and I'm going deep into my memory of like Bible studies and everything, mm-hmm. but his wife Sarah was 90 years old, couldn't have a child. And so he ended up having a child instead with the, you know, one of the handmaids of Sarah. So they lived in the house and would be considered like a concubine. So they had a child, and that child was Ishmael.
Yes, of course.
Right? So we have a bad estate plan. And by some miracle, Sarah gets pregnant.
Got it.
At the ripe old age of 90 years old. Right? And they lived longer then. That's the other thing.
Got
they
it.
Lived longer. From the pre-flood times, everyone lived much, much longer. Like Adam lived 930 years. Methuselah was said to have lived 969 years. Mm-hmm. Right? Enoch lived 365 years.
Moses too, yeah.
Moses was 120-something years. So this thing caused the schism that we have now in the Middle East, because Ishmael was the older son and then so should have gotten the birthright. Mm-hmm. But because his mother was not was actually just this handmaid of Sarah, the birthright didn't pass to that. And this is why in Judaism, unless your mother's Jewish, you're not automatically Jewish.
Correct.
Right?
Yeah.
That's the thing. That's why it has to pass through the mother. And I always ask people when I go to Israel, they're like, it's the only way to be sure. God chose us. We didn't choose him. That's what they always say to me. So...
Okay, so going back to the Ark of the Covenant, what actually is in the covenant? What's in it?
So
we saw Indiana Jones. So
yeah, that's right.
So what is it exactly?
Okay, so the Ark of the Covenant, I think there's the Bible story, which sure. I don't totally buy into.
Shocking. Go ahead.
Okay.
You mean to tell me that there's things in the Bible?
And I've never talked. This is you're going down a path I've never gone down on podcast.
Generally, that's why we have a conversation.
That's why we have our conversations. Okay, so the Ark of the Covenant was this box. It had certain dimensions. It was made of acacia wood. Mm-hmm. Acacia wood is the tree that is pretty prominent down there. I was mm-hmm. just in Aswan with Matthias DiStefano, mm-hmm. and we were looking, you know, at these islands that were on there, and all the trees there were acacia wood. Mm-hmm. The acacia wood tree has DMT. Mm. So we start talking about the burning bush. The burning bush was acacia. Mm-hmm. Okay. So were there psychedelics involved for Moses that he had this, you know, godlike experience?
That's interesting.
The burning bush was DMT.
Okay.
And it's a well-known DMT.
Interesting.
In fact, I have this new geometry set coming out that's made of acacia wood boxes. Please don't burn the boxes. They're really hard to make, okay? But I wanted it to be something really special like that. So, but acacia wood has this unique property. It's like kind of like an ayahuasca. Mm-hmm. And there are ceremonies that you can have with acacia. It's a full-on ayahuasca type ceremony.
Interesting.
Yeah. And I know lots of people that have done it.
So it's made out of this wood.
Yep.
And then, but what's inside of it?
So what's inside of it is subject to a lot of speculation.
Yes.
Right? It's supposed to house the power of God.
Okay.
Okay. Now this box, yeah, let's go back to the story of Moses for a moment and then we'll edge into this part of the story. So the box has these perfect dimensions. The perfect dimensions with the poles that fit it. So they had to carry it a certain way. And only priests that were of what they call the Cohen family, mm-hmm. right? Which these would be the sons of Levi, mm-hmm. right? So the sons of Aaron and Levi, this whole story where you've got Aaron, who was the mouthpiece for Moses, mm-hmm. because he was a better orator, he was a better public speaker. Mm-hmm. And so Aaron's line was blessed, right? And this was the Levitical tribe, mm-hmm. was blessed to be the not only the rabbis, but the high priest that would actually be allowed to work in the temple, mm-hmm. right? And the Ark, where the Ark of the Covenant was. And until they built the temple, which didn't happen until around 1000 BC, mm-hmm. which would have been with Solomon, right? You've got Solomon and you got Saul, David, then Solomon, mm-hmm. right? And until the temple was built, they had this tabernacle, right? So when Moses escaped from Egypt and they followed him to the Red Sea, and then, the Pharaoh, Ramses, was like his army was sort of destroyed because they got stuck in the Red Sea, mm-hmm. just like in the Cecil mm-hmm. B. DeMille movie, right? What happened was no one really knew why all of a sudden, because Ramses had said, you can go. Get out of here. We're tired of you. Remember, they already sent the pestilence and the plagues, and they already sent the locusts and the mm-hmm. frogs, and they already—
blood in the water.
Yeah. And the firstborn son, right? And mm-hmm. the loss of the firstborn son of Ramses as well. Mm-hmm. So he's like, just go. Just go. Well, something happened that made those, dynastic Egyptians run after Moses and say, no, come back. We're not letting you go. What was it? Well, interestingly, the Ark of the Covenant proportions and dimensions perfectly fit inside the sarcophagus of the Great Pyramid.
Mm.
It's a perfect match.
Okay.
So there are many that posit, and I'm in that list, that the Ark of the Covenant was actually in the sarcophagus, and it was the conductor for the Great Pyramid. It's made of gold. Right. So the box, even though in the book, right, it tells the story in the Bible about how they're told how to make the Ark of the Covenant, and there is more than one Ark, by the way. Mm-hmm. There's more than one Ark. They were probably in several different pyramids around the world. The Ark of the Covenant was supposed to be made of these proportions. I think it's 2.5 cubits by 1.5 cubits. And it had these poles that had to go on it. You couldn't touch the ark. And the outer surface of it was gold. Well, gold is one of the best conductors, right?
Correct.
And it had the unique attribute as well that at the top of it, there were two angels. And these cherubim angels had wings that basically stretched out to each other, just like in the movie. Mm-hmm. And there were four faces. If you could reach in there and look at it, there are four faces on each of the angels' faces. Mm-hmm. And the four faces were the face of a man, the face of a bull, the face of an eagle, and the face of a lion.
Okay.
Now, if you know your zodiac, you would know mm-hmm. the face of a man is Aquarius. Mm-hmm. You would know that the face of the bull is Taurus. Mm-hmm. The face of the lion, of course, is Leo. You might not know that the face of eagle is Scorpio. These are what we call the fixed signs, right, in the zodiac, right? They're the ones that sort of mark the positions of the zodiac the most, right?
Right, right.
They're the center of them. They're the center thesis also of each of their, their element relationships. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So basically, the Great Pyramid is also built with that orientation. The Great Pyramid, if you haven't seen this film, there's a great film called The Revelations of the Pyramid. Mm-hmm. It was a French film that's translated into English. You can find it on Gaia now. I think mm-hmm. they took it off YouTube now. It's probably the best show that there is that explains a thesis of what the pyramid actually was. And they presented the entire Giza Plateau as a giant clock mm-hmm. that's based on the zodiac. And they show the orientation of each of the sides, where they have the orientation of the entrance of the Great Pyramid, because it's Bull Mountain, mm-hmm. is the bull, the mm-hmm. north side, and that's where you enter in the pyramid from. So the north side's the bull, the south side would be the eagle, But actually, it starts off with a scorpion. Then the scorpion transforms and gets redeemed into a snake. Mm-hmm. And then the snake transforms and redeems into an eagle. And then that redemption process continues to turn the eagle into a phoenix. And then the phoenix becomes, eventually, the phoenix becomes the Ophiuchus,
okay,
which is the 13th zodiac sign. And it's the serpent bearer. So it becomes the story of Asclepius, right? Asclepius is the one who saved the life of Orion when he was stung by a scorpion, which was really just, you know, scorpion venom is the most expensive drug in the world right now.
Mm-hmm.
$39 million per gallon.
Jesus.
And it's an ego death. It's like Iboga or like Bufo or any of these things that people are all doing right now to experience ego death. This is just a more intense way of experiencing ego death. And that's what I believe is the actual metaphor story of the story of Orion. Mm. Orion and Ophiuchus are just opposite each other in the night sky, right? They're exactly opposite each other. So the orientation of the Great Pyramid being according to the zodiac is matching the description in the Bible, in the book of Ezekiel, of the Ark of the Covenant also having all four of those faces on it, because they represent the four sides of the walls in the Great Pyramid's King's Chamber that also, you asked what we discovered in there, shows the zodiac of all of those, but not just the 12 zodiac signs. It shows the, in total, 48 zodiac signs, because the Egyptian year was split into 36 segments. Mm-hmm. So 10 days for each segment. You know, they would look at, okay, yes, you're in Taurus, but there's a subset of Taurus. And the subset of Taurus is Orion, Auriga, and Eridanus, right? And so these different aspects give you more specificity. So if you look at the degree of where you're born, right, on your birth chart or your natal chart, you could actually find out that there's way more complexity. It's like the next dimension of the zodiac. And this was the Atlantean calendar also. So you could find out, like, I was born in the week of Orion, right? May 16th is the week of Orion in the Vedic calendar, right? So that means I would take on certain Orion characteristics, right? And that's always had some resonance for me. So it was, you know, I never knew that that was a thing, right? Until I started studying all this stuff. Well, this deacon of astrology has been around a long time. And all the walls are etched with all 36 of the symbols of each of those constellations. And so on the west wall, that's behind the sarcophagus, there's a big lion's face.
Mm-hmm.
You've seen it
I
now.
I saw it.
Right? You've seen it, and you actually saw it on Apple Vision Pro on my new, you know, sort of virtual reality game thing that I created. What did you think of that, by the way?
It's pretty badass, I have to say. I was like, wow, this is kind of ridiculous. It was pretty amazing. I was there. It was pretty amazing.
It's like you're there, and you come out of it, you're like, whoa, we live in a simulation.
Absolutely.
As soon as you take that off, you're like, we live in a simulation.
There's no question.
Think about where this technology would go in 5 or 10 years. It's like
100, just 100 years from now. Where do you think that's going to go?
I mean, smell, everything. It's all going to be there.
We're going to the holodeck.
You know, Google just came out with this whole new thing called Google Nose. Have you seen this?
No. Oh, no.
Yeah, it can smell. It's like Shazam for like smelling.
Of course.
Can you believe that?
Of course. No, I have no doubt. No doubt.
There's a possibility it was an April Fool's joke when I saw it, but I looked it up all over the place. So they really took the April Fool's joke really far. And then I ran out of time to find out if it was legit or not. But,
yeah.
But here's the thing. The room is basically giving us a map of time. And it's oriented backwards. So it's not just giving us the map, the way that it should go clockwise and counterclockwise. It shows us the two-directional nature of time.
Mm-hmm.
See, we go forward in procession of equinox. So if we just think of the 12 zodiac signs, right? We go from Capricorn into Aquarius, right? And then Aquarius into Pisces, then Pisces into Aries, and Aries into Taurus, and Taurus into Gemini, and Gemini into Cancer, and Cancer into Leo, right? And then you go into Virgo and Libra, right? And you're going through this whole cycle. But by the same time that we're doing that, we're also going backwards. If you look at the sky, don't look at your clock. Look at the sky instead. Because what happens is as we move from Aquarius into Pisces on a month-to-month basis, we're slowly, but by the same degree of proportion, moving backwards. And this is why we just went on an aeon basis, which is 2,000 years. Sri Yukteswar, 24,000 year cycle, right? So each of the aeons is 2,000 years, right? And within that, there's fractals that then have these trends. Like sometimes people like gold and sometimes they like silver and sometimes they like, you know, metals and stuff like that. It's matching all the collective consciousness as well. It's all part of the simulation game that we live in.
Is that why gold is a little bit higher priced now than it's ever been before?
Because it's more popular again. Because you know why?
Why?
Because we're in Aquarius now. Mm-hmm. And what is our opposite sign from Aquarius? Leo. Mm-hmm. And what does Leo represent? Gold.
Does he?
Yeah. The sun.
So is gold, where's gold going? 10,000?
Gold's going to go up. It's going to go way up, right? Because the dollar is going to, I believe the dollar is going to go way down.
Well, yeah, that's, I mean, anyone can see that coming.
Well, yeah, I mean, this is why Bitcoin speculation has mm-hmm. been so big this year. And I mean, we could spend a whole different podcast just on that. But the point is that we go backwards in time by the same degree, like a Mobius strip or a Klein bottle. You mm-hmm. know what a Klein bottle is?
I don't.
Klein bottle would be like a bottle like this, mm-hmm. right? But that has a spout that comes out of it and that it wraps around itself and then comes back into itself.
Okay.
Right? A Mobius strip would be if I had like a piece of paper, a strip of paper, and I was going to make a little bracelet like we did in elementary school. If I twist it 540 degrees, right? And I put it around my wrist with that twist in it, mm-hmm. it'll look kind of like DNA. Mm-hmm. DNA is a Mobius strip. Mm-hmm. DNA is a Mobius strip.
Yeah.
So you twist this strip. And then if I have a little Mattel car, right? The little ones that the kids play with, I can, and I twisted a thing like that and I could defy gravity. Mm-hmm. I could let the car go. It would end up going on both sides of the paper.
Okay.
Because of the twist. Right. This is the nature of the Mobius strip. So what this basically shows is that time can loop back on itself.
So I'm going to stop you there for a second because this is something I've wanted to talk to you about. I was talking to some channels the other day, some scientists the other day, and this concept of there is no past life, there's no future life, that all lives are happening at the same time.
Yeah.
That concept, which has been explained to me and I've spoken about it on the show, how you can kind of wrap your head around that. Mm-hmm. But there was a scientist or researcher who told me that, well, imagine that we're looking at it linear. Time is actually stacked on top of each other. So it's all happening at the same time. And quantum jumping is being able to jump
between
with ease. Yeah. Because we're not going back or forward. It's all at the same level, but just at different times. And then we get into the spiritual aspect of it is that, well, that's the oversoul living all of its lives at the same time. And when you were talking about, what we were talking about earlier of, it looks like someone in the Great Pyramid, someone came in and did it afterwards. Or we were talking about our future selves, our past, you know, our future selves coming back to talk to us in a way, that's a form of quantum jumping. I talked to someone yesterday who was transported, not a vision, not felt like physically her essence, her consciousness transported back to Atlantis, where she was in the room and started to explaining everything to me. And I was like, I mean, it was pretty mind-blowing. So what are your thoughts on what I'm just talking about, this idea of
I've experienced it.
So tell me.
I experienced it once.
Okay.
I've always been able to see the future.
Okay.
Right. When I was 19 years old, I was a Mormon missionary in Korea.
Okay.
And I'm not Mormon anymore, but I left when I was 30 years old. But I had a dream. In the middle of the night, I woke up my missionary companion. And in my dream, my girlfriend, who was going to BYU at the time, was driving a car. It was a beige Toyota. And she was driving, it was around Christmas time, so she was driving home to Nebraska from Utah. And which is like a long straight drive through cornfields. She fell asleep at the wheel. One of my friends was in the front seat with her. And she rolled the car into a ditch in the dream. I saw the license plate number. I'd never seen the car before. Mm-hmm. I saw the license plate number. I saw blood covering her and the other guy. And I saw that he broke his neck. And I was so worried about it. And as a missionary, we were not allowed to call home. You couldn't call home. That was sort of the whole thing. Like, mm-hmm. you're there for, it's like being, you're in a monastery, you mm-hmm. know, mm-hmm. unless you're going to leave, they're not going to do anything. And I wasn't going to leave. So I called the mission president and I said, I'd like to call home. And kind of like, and this, I don't know if this has happened or not. And he's thinking, okay, this kid might just be crazy. Mm-hmm. Well, I didn't call home. And I found out about a week later because they didn't want to tell me on Christmas Day. They sent me a letter that the same exact thing happened 9 hours after the dream. Wow. So it was a like exactly down to the license plate on the car. And the car I'd never seen before. And the guy died. And
so what is that? Is that because that was a dream though?
That was a dream.
That was a dream. So is dreaming a form of quantum jumping?
Yes, it can be.
It can be, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
because once you dreams can be connecting your subconscious, mm-hmm. right? It's from your subconscious.
Right.
And your subconscious is where you're closest to your oversoul, mm-hmm. right? That's where, and so the way that the oversoul can communicate with us is through synchronicities and through dreams. Hmm. That's one of the most common ways until we learn how to master the balance that's necessary, because we have to be able to achieve a high degree of hemisynchronization of our two left and right brains, which is really the alpha and omega. And once that happens, then the chi comes in. And what is the chi? The chi is the optic nerve that connects the right eye to the left brain and the left eye to the right brain. Mm-hmm. It crosses over at the pituitary gland. The pituitary gland, this is called the optic chiasm.
Right.
And then it connects back to the occipital lobe, right? Mm-hmm. So what we're seeing inside of our brain, there's no photons in there. We're just doing an interpretation from what's coming into our retinal receptors of what photons it would be picking up. Mm-hmm. Then flipping the image upside down, mm-hmm. because for us, if we actually could see what we're truly seeing, it's an upside down image, just like a camera, mm-hmm. right, would be. And then it's getting interpolated. There's no photons in my head, right, that you would think. Right? There are that are just from the ambient molecules and the the electrons that are inside my brain, right, mm-hmm. or the elements that are inside my brain that make it up. But basically, we are doing an interpolation of a matrix simulation. Already inside of our brains. It's mm-hmm. just happening at the back of our brains. So when we finally find this balance, then we get into this what's called heart-brain coherence. Mm-hmm. The heart-brain coherence is what mystics, what Sri Yukteswar, what all the Babaji, all of these guys became masters at. They learned how to balance their feminine energy with their masculine energy and bring them so that they're no longer in conflict one with another. And it even comes down to the point where you have to finally realize, you know what? Maybe my rational mind will never fully grasp my irrational mind, but it can value it, right? Like, I may never fully understand the reason for irrationality, but look, I do love the curve. Mm-hmm. The curve is something I've been eternally fascinated by. It's like, oh, it's so beautiful. It's like life would be boring with only straight lines.
Right.
So I've learned to value that. And so therefore, the feminine aspect that might seem totally emotional to the left brain has an incredible value in intuition. It allows people that have the balance to think and feel at the same time. And when the heart thinks and the mind feels, that's when the river of wisdom flows. And that river of wisdom is your Kundalini life force. Mm. So this is when it starts to light up your chakras, right? And this is all the stuff I know you've studied because I know all the books you've read. Right, but this is just maybe a different way of looking at it. I came at it more from the Western esoterica than from the Eastern. And then I went back and studied Eastern. But it's still the same thing. Hermetic wisdom is the same as Eastern. You have hermetic alchemists that were in China as well. They're all doing the same thing. It's learning how to transmute the metaphor of lead into gold. And that metaphor is taking the negative experience of our suffering. And once we finally have the context of the meaning behind the suffering, and it makes us more divine, and it also makes the one even more aware of itself, because it's dividing itself into all of our eyes of perception so that it can perceive itself through our unique eyes of perception. Nobody with my eyes has ever seen the world before, and no one will ever see it again because I have a unique parentage. I have a unique conditioning bias set. Mm-hmm. I have a unique, you know, environmental factors. I have a unique world. Mm-hmm. This play stage that we have this background of, we all have like one big oversoul. Mm-hmm. And humanity, I believe, is represented by Orion constellation. Mm-hmm. And it's the story of the hero's journey. Orion is the hero. We're all in our own hero's journey. Mm-hmm. That oversoul has many names. We could say it's Yahweh for some, the lesser Yahweh for others, Metatron for some, Thoth. I mean, you can go to a whole list of different names that this could be. Some think there's 108 names, some think there's 72 names. They're all the same because there's only one thing. there's you in your experience and your you inverse around you. Mm-hmm. It's just divided light so that it can perceive itself. And then we finally learn our oneness and we come back together as one. And that's also joy for Source Creator.
So the idea of the quantum jumping, to be able to go back and forth, do you believe that? Because a lot of times people talk about aliens and those kind of interactions. What's your experience with that? Have you had any experience with not only, because UFOs are now becoming a very mainstream, everyone's talking about them, but even in the past, you know, from the Anunnaki to all these kind of things, what kind of experience do you have in that, or stories have you heard?
You know, I don't believe the Anunnaki were one race of aliens, right? You could say it was like a consortium, a bunch of different alien species. And what is alien? I don't like the word alien. You could call them extraterrestrial or intraterrestrial. I believe they've been here all along. It's not a function of whether or not these so-called aliens or extraterrestrials or intraterrestrials are here or not. They're always here. The only question is humanity in a cycle where we are allowed access through higher dimensional perspectives to be able to perceive them?
If you're enjoying this conversation, I invite you to go deeper down the rabbit hole with me on Next Level Soul TV. It's packed with exclusive content like live special guest Q&As, daily podcasts, commercial-free access to the entire Next Level Soul catalog, early access to episodes before they air, and special meditations you won't find anywhere else. We will be adding new exclusive content every month. Plus, you can connect with me during my monthly live streams. Just go to nextlevelsoul.com/subscribe and join our soulful community today. I'll see you on the inside. And that's where we're going. That's why you're seeing more and more of them now, because we're starting to, our consciousness as humanity is growing.
Yeah. The stuff that I've been finding in the Great Pyramid, right? It's always been there.
Yeah.
It's always been there. I mean, I go back and look at photographs. Now, you could say maybe there's some strange Mandela thing going on. Who knows? Mm-hmm. But what I believe, because I can go back and look at photographs that I took where I walked in and I didn't see any of the stuff that I now see all over the walls. For me, it's like a color, technicolor experience. I walk in, you got a glimpse of it today through the Apple Vision Pro, right? And then once you see it, you can't unsee it.
Right.
And as Da Vinci said, there are three types of people: those who can see, those who can see once shown, and those who don't see. Mm-hmm. Not everyone will see, right? And that's okay, because it's a higher dimensional experience. So the way you get to that higher dimensional experience is through this hemisynchronization of the minds. The left and right brains coming together, the chi forms, right? And that creates this electrical canopy over your hypothalamus and thalamus, which is that walnut, and that's the knob on the staff of Hermes. So the knob on the staff of Hermes goes straight through your spine, the 33 vertebrae, goes all the way up to that center point of your brain where the pineal and pituitary gland are. And it's just like through a breathing exercise, you can actually move your pituitary gland because it's slightly lower than the pineal gland does. You can actually take it as you breathe, just like with a heart. If you look at a CNA fluoroscopy on the heart, as you breathe, you see the heart pumping, right? Pumping in and out. Our brains do the same thing with our breaths. Just nobody thinks of it like that. We think of our heart, it's not encased in this hard, you know, cranium.
Right.
And so we don't think of it like that. But if you look at an MRI, right, or one of those motion CAT scans, then you'll actually see how the brain expands and contracts with our breaths as well. So as you take in a breath and you hold it deep, and you know how you do that extra thing when you're meditating, and you kind of like I do breath work, and you take in, and then to get extra breath, you go through your mouth sometimes, that last one, that extra leap, and with your intention can push your pituitary gland so that it can, almost like the two fingers in Michelangelo's Sistine Chapel depiction, where God is reaching out
and touching
to Adam and touching, those two parts of your anatomy can basically touch and create this electrical connection, which then sparks an enlightenment.
The one thing I love talking about is obviously spirituality and raising our consciousness. And I'm now starting to connect these ETs, aliens, ideas behind that. I've long been telling people, I'm like, look, if and I'd love to hear your thoughts. Independence Day is not going to happen. There, if you're traveling across the universe and you have the technology to cross the universe, you're generally a higher vibration, higher frequency being. You're not going to come to conquer. There's no aliens like the, you know, predators or that's wonderful for Hollywood, but that doesn't exist. So if we do encounter, you know, extraterrestrials, or now we're starting to see them, they're going to be at a higher level of consciousness and frequency than we are. So much so that when we talk, I know, our mutual friend, Daryl Anka, who does Bashar,
yeah,
he said very often, like, if Bashar would show up, we wouldn't be able to handle his frequency.
His vibration.
Yeah. We would be just, like, literally just by him walking near us.
And some people might not even be able to see him.
Correct. And that's the other thing, that now we're starting to see so many more things, these things that you've started to see. I said this to somebody the other day. I was like, well, all the technology we have right now, our phones, the cars, all the materials to do everything has always been here. All of it. The concept of the internet.
100 years ago, this is straight magic.
Oh, absolutely.
Things I could do with this?
Oh, my God. Yeah, the internet would be, it's essentially.
Yeah, all the libraries of Earth can be stored and I can access all of it
in an instant. Instantaneously. That all of that technology has always been here, but we were not allowed to see it.
Yeah.
And we are now seeing things so much faster, because even in our lifetime, how much has changed.
So imagine now, because people ask me this all the time.
Yeah.
Why are things hidden?
Because we're not ready for them.
They're hidden so that they can be found, but only found by the people along their journey of raising their consciousness.
Correct.
Right? So here's the thing. The reason why there are some people that would see aliens and have all these experiences, or extraterrestrials, is because they were already vibing at a higher frequency. So birds have different frequency of vision. Mm-hmm. We can see a limited spectrum of light, mm-hmm. right? We can see something between, on the very, very lowest end, one octave of light, mm-hmm. starting at 360 nanometers, mm-hmm. right? Up to 720 nanometers. Mm-hmm. It's exactly like one octave, right? Mm-hmm. So 720 nanometers is going to be pushing you towards, you know, what we call the red spectrum. So it's going to be you're going to start to get in near infrared. Mm-hmm. And then at 360 nanometers, you're going to be in the blue light spectrum, which is going to be, you know, the more feminine side of this, which is, ultraviolet mm-hmm. and blue. Mm-hmm. So that's the range that we can see. But birds can see beyond our ranges. Mm-hmm. So, like, you'll see these birds that have all these iridescent colors and stuff. And I couldn't really see iridescence that well before, not until I tried mushrooms. Mm-hmm. And then I could start seeing iridescence mm-hmm. that I couldn't see before. I could start seeing auras, right? I could see your aura right now. Mm-hmm. These are things I couldn't see before. But
how's it looking?
Kind of orangey. Okay. Orange and orange, yellow.
What does that mean?
Golden. Oh, that means you're in general balance. Mm-hmm. Not as much green. Mm-hmm. So you can open your heart a little bit more. Mm-hmm. Those are the things. And a little less on the feminine side. So some of the higher chakras right now, I mean, they have cameras that do this and capture mm-hmm. this stuff. And you could do this better than what I'm doing right now, but mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure this is what you would see. And so your higher chakras are not fully vibing all the way yet. So mm-hmm. the pineal, pituitary, but it's not that it's not there. It's there. I could see it. And psychics and others who basically have this ability would be able to read this on you as well. Mm-hmm. But where you're very good, like you're almost overbalanced, mm-hmm. is in your kidneys. Mm-hmm. Your kidneys, that's why you've got a lot of kind of orange mm-hmm. light and solar plexus light. You use a lot of your willpower. Mm-hmm. Right now, you use a lot of willpower. Mm-hmm. And what I would say to you is you could probably reduce the willpower a little bit and things would go, you almost just like surrender to it. And things would actually go just as smooth or better without having to exert yourself so much in that. Does that resonate at all?
Yeah, it does.
Sorry about that. You asked.
No, I asked. No, it's very true, because I'm a director by nature.
Yeah. You want to control everything.
I'd like to.
I mean, come on, dude.
I mean.
this place, I mean, like, come on. I can see you walking around. You've got the little Indiana Jones head over there, too.
Of course.
It's like, come on.
The Holy Grail's behind you.
Oh, my gosh.
Like, the Holy Grail's behind you, of course.
Come on.
Of course, there's Easter eggs all over this
place.
You've
even planned for the love over there. I love that.
No, and the wake, and of course.
This place is like, wow, this is like a little little playroom for me. So,
but that's it's very fascinating because a lot of people are starting. Well, like in our time, in our lifetime, we've had so much growth, and things are growing so fast. Now it's
so fast.
It's daily, monthly, something new's popping up. And as I'm watching it all, because what I do with this show and with my own journey is I'm trying to connect the dots. Like I've said before, I'm trying to see the whole elephant and not the tail or the leg or the ear or something like that. I'm trying to put all the elephant together and put the puzzle pieces together. So by talking to every spectrum.
When's your birthday?
June 28th.
June 20th. Okay. So you're a Cancer.
I am, sir.
Yeah. So you've got a lot of heart. Mm-hmm. But there's also a resistance that you have to being too weighted on the heart side, mm-hmm. which is interesting, mm-hmm. right? So, but actually it's who you are because I feel like that. First of all, I said that to you already. I feel like I've known you forever.
Yeah, same here.
And it's kind of like, I told him, I'm like, definitely we were on the Millennium Falcon together at some point.
And I'm not Chewbacca.
And you're not Chewbacca.
I am not Chewbacca.
We'll ask your wife if that's true.
I love Chewbacca, but I am not Chewbacca. I could be Han Solo or Luke or even Obi-Wan.
But are you Harry?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm Latino, sir. Okay.
I'm just kidding. So anyway, but to your point, to your question,
yeah.
Why is this all happening now? Well, people are raising their consciousness. As they raise their consciousness, everyone's going to start seeing more and more of it. But so global contact, and everyone talks about global contact, is about where we are, not where about where are. The aliens are. They've been here all along.
Let me ask you then, because there's been talks of, okay, now we're going to go a little bit more esoteric.
But that also answers your question, right? Because you cannot be in higher dimension unless you've already mastered these lower dimensional principles
of
hemisynchronization of your brain. Mm-hmm. So you can't be in higher dimensional. So, we're in the 4D right now. Mm-hmm. Now, Arcturians are what they would call themselves future humans. Mm-hmm. Future from our perspective, but time becomes irrelevant once you go into the fifth and sixth dimensions. Mm-hmm. It becomes less important. At the fifth dimension, you start realizing that that's what we're going into now. That time flows forward and back. There's only now.
Which is the stacking.
The stacking. Exactly. So you can jump. There are all these different dimensions of you through all your different lifetimes that are happening simultaneous to now. The avatar state of consciousness, just like in the show that's on Netflix right now,
great
Last
show.
Airbender.
Yeah, great show.
The avatar state is when you can tap into all of those lifetimes and capture all the knowledge that you learned in all those lifetimes. You didn't know how to be a sculptor in this lifetime. But you were in the last, you can now access it.
Let me ask you this, though. That's a very interesting point. Would that be what yogis are doing?
Yes.
When they find enlightenment?
Yes. Enlightenment is not just, I'm in love.
No.
Guru means light from dark.
No, but they connect to something. They're connecting to something that opens them up to a place where they're connected to the universe, essentially.
That's right. And all the knowledge
comes rushing
in. Is there. So the science, the math, everything is
all
there.
Of it. Yeah.
We don't need, it's like we all think that we have to go to school to learn.
No.
Does a whale need to go to whale school to learn to be a whale? No. It knows how to raise its own consciousness to do all the things that whales do. It knows it from the start. It's like certain animals, they're born, like a horse can run right after it is born, right?
Yeah.
We start thinking about our lives differently. We start realizing that, wait a minute, this is my birthright. I have access to all the information in the world. This has just been a little training wheel for that.
Yeah.
And cataloged it for us. But actually, we can take it all in. And what we have to do to be able to process it is understand the quadrivium. Mm-hmm. Quadrivium is, Pythagoras said all is number. Plato says all is number. What the quadrivium is it's arithmetic, geometry, music, and cosmology. Mm-hmm. Arithmetic is number in itself. Geometry is number in space, music is number in time, and cosmology is number in space-time.
Interesting.
Okay? Once you study these four discipline areas, that is like figuring out a way how to titrate your receiver so that the conceiver, the oversoul, the higher self, is the conceiver. Your brain is the receiver, and your consciousness in its divided state, is the perceiver. This is what Daryl told me during my podcast with him. He said, this is what Bashar explains, conceiver, receiver, and perceiver. And that so resonated with me. Like, it was like, oh my gosh, that's like, wow. So when we start to realize that we can tap into this higher conscious state, and there are different levels of it. It's not like something that's just instant. You know, you're like in between stages. And so that's where humanity is right now. Some people are experiencing fifth dimensional experience right now. Mm-hmm. Many people are. And that's the people that have chosen love over more judgment. Judgment is the opposite of love. Mm-hmm. It's not fear and it's not hatred. Mm-hmm. Right? Those are different aspects that feel kind of similar, but I never felt comfortable with the idea that the opposite of love was either hatred or fear.
Right.
Yeah. But judgment nails it for me. Because anytime you have judgment, mm-hmm. you've placed conditionality on something. And if you're here to learn a precept of love, if you're here to learn unconditional love, then you will have a lifetime of experiences of conditional love. Because we learn through opposites. If I'm here to learn pleasure, I'm going to experience pain over and over and over again until I no longer either judge negatively pain, right, or fear the pain anymore. Mm. The moment I no longer judge something negatively is when I've actually learned its opposite. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. We learn through opposites. So our entire life experience here is about experiencing all of this as a dimensionally limited avatar that has an oversoul. The oversoul is chosen to experience itself through our eyes. Mm-hmm. There's no mistakes. No mistakes. We're not making mistakes. The one wants to learn empathy for every possible circumstance and perspective. And it can learn its greater wisdom because it's a philomath, a lover of learning and a lover of wisdom, philosopher, mm-hmm. in the ancient sense. It divides itself so that it can experience all these different perspectives of angular degrees of perception through our unique eyes that can become billions and billions and millions of people and will always become more and more and more so that it can learn itself. Because as Alan Watts said, an eye can't see itself without the aid of a mirror. Mm-hmm. Consciousness can't perceive itself. A knife can't cut itself. A tooth can't bite itself. A fire can't burn itself. So as we go to these higher levels of consciousness, and once we've balanced our brain and we know how to process, because there's a little bit of a processor in there too. We have to have some understanding of things. So by studying quadrivium, we can tune the tuner.
So then how, when yogis, I'll go back to yogis. When yogis are meditating, mm-hmm. What's actually happening in their chakra system that is opening up or leveling up their frequency to the point where they can start to access more and more of this universal knowledge? Because from my experience talking to near-death experiencers, there has been many of them that they go in there and they just ask a question and it just is answered. Or they get downloads of the, oh, that's what quantum physics is. Oh, that's all of mathematics. Oh, that's all of that. And it's all in there. They can't bring it back because our processor can't handle it, but they bring back moments of it or clips of it or little
yeah,
things
like
of it.
Insights.
But the brain literally can't grasp it.
But that's why it's so important, because you can if you study the quadrivium and you know it well.
Correct. Mm-hmm. But then with a yogi.
Like Sri Yukteswar.
Yeah.
He is a good example of this. Yes. Holy science,
yes.
Right? Yeah. So he brought forward a lot of knowledge and information that was very scientific, but it was couched in the context of spirituality.
Correct. But from what I understand, and correct me if I'm wrong, is when a yogi or an ascended master or an avatar of some sort gets to a certain level, they're literally hooked up to the internet of the universal,
yes.
universal internet. So in other words, our iPad or our computer is limited. But when it hooks up to the internet,
it's unlimited. And
completely.
So what is it that changes in them?
Yeah. What is it that changes in them? Is that true is what I'm saying. Does that make sense?
100% true.
Okay.
100% true.
Okay.
So you could think of like your spine as a meter. So think of it as a meter, mm-hmm. and it's probably about a meter well.
Okay.
Think of it as a meter that you can use for metrology, for measurement of things. And the more base you are, mm-hmm. the more judgment you carry.
Okay.
So you could think of this as a judgment love meter. So as you go up higher and higher states of consciousness, you're moving more and more towards states of love. The highest is love, right? Mm-hmm. Bucky Fuller. You know who Bucky Fuller was?
Name sounds familiar.
Buckminster Fuller was a famous architect, geometer.
Yeah.
Right? And polymath. Mm-hmm. And he says that love is metaphysical gravity.
Interesting.
So love is the thing that binds the universe together. Mm-hmm. Right? And maybe that's why it's the darkness of the universe, because we don't understand it. We think that darkness is the absence of light. It's not. Darkness is the absorbed condition of light. It's the absorption of light, not the opposite condition of it. If we turn all the lights off in here, you did it right before. You did the, mm-hmm. I'm not going to do it right now. Yeah. I won't even say the word.
Yeah.
But you said a word that starts with A-L-E-X-A.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it's like you can literally turn everything off.
Correct.
Right, instantly. If we did that right now,
yeah.
Right, there's still light in the room. Mm-hmm. We don't perceive that light. Right, because our eyes are not tuned to be able to see that light.
Whatever leakage is in, what you mean, light leakage or?
The very first light in the universe is hydrogen.
Uh-huh.
So if there is a element of hydrogen in the room, even one atom of hydrogen, it's emitting photons of light.
Fair enough.
Okay, and it will emit those photons according to its resonance frequency. So its resonance frequency can be defined in what's called spectral reflection and spectral absorption. So I can look at the spectral reflection, which looks like a band, all black, mm-hmm. right? And there's like four lines of pinks and reds and blues and violet that represent hydrogen. This is how we know. We look into outer space and we could say, oh, we see these nanometers of light, these exact combination of nanometers, then we know the composition of what's in outer space. It's hydrogen. Mm-hmm. Because those are very unique light signatures. You have a light signature. All of your body is made up of DNA, right? Mm-hmm. Ultimately, that DNA is made up of a combination of the elements that basically go into the building blocks of our DNA, which is carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen, mm-hmm. right? Those are the four. You got sulfur and phosphate, you know, for phosphate backbone. But those are the combinations of things that could make your entire light signature. So by this token, you could look at other star systems and say, wait, so if we have a certain light signature associated with a certain star, is that star really just a gigantic, as above, so below element of carbon, maybe mm-hmm. cobalt, mm-hmm. if it's more blue? Mm-hmm. If the star is red, might it be something altogether different, right? You see what I'm saying? Is it more hydrogen related? Are we just looking at gigantic versions of atoms? I believe so, yes. That's what I believe. I believe what we're actually looking at, the reason why our sun has its yellow color, because mm-hmm. it's a carbon sun. We are in that dimension, which would tell you that we're in the fourth dimension. Fourth dimension is going to be associated also with carbon.
So different sun colors will determine the different consciousnesses
yes.
of the
you
beings.
You noticed how the sun, when we were young, was way more orangey yellow. Mm-hmm. Now it's more white when it's at noonday.
Mm-hmm.
You notice that?
Mm-hmm.
It's changing. Because it's moving up to the next octave. The next octave is going to take it beyond fluorine. So when we were growing up, we had 9 planets in the solar system.
Yes, right, Pluto.
Right, Pluto. Pluto is a planet. Now they downgraded it because they said, oh, it's too small to be a planet. They call it a dwarf planet. Mm-hmm. But okay, it's still a planet. So what would be 9 electrons? So 9 electrons on an atom would give you fluorine. That's the last element before going into the octave jump. The next octave jump mm-hmm. would take us into the silica range. So silicon is the center. So you've got the center of a wave is hydrogen. Mm-hmm. The center of the next wave, right, of elements on the periodic elements table, which is actually a wave of elements, mm-hmm. is carbon. And the next one up from there is silicon, right? Well, as we're going through our transition in our DNA, right? We're moving up to a more complex structure of elementary makeup of our atoms. That more complex structure means that that which was more carbon oriented before now moves into a more silicone orientation, crystallization. What is quartz crystal? It's silicone dioxide.
Right.
Okay. We're moving more into a crystal form. Even our DNA is now taking on that characteristic. We're up leveling from the carbon octave. So what does that mean? Well, it means that very soon, I'll make a prediction, they will discover probably as we continue this expansion, It's as above, so below, as within, so without. As we discover and go more and more into the fifth dimensional experience, they're going to discover three new planets.
In our solar system.
In our solar system.
How could they discover three new planets? Farther than Pluto?
I guarantee if you look it up right now on the internet, you will find that they are now positing at least two, if not three new planets that are not necessarily new. They think they've been there all along, but they're seeing the gravitational signature of them now.
Is that past Pluto?
Yeah, they'd be in the Kuiper Belt, right? Or called exoplanets. Mm-hmm. But that would be also true when you look at electrons, right? That are moving into these higher states. So you go into magnesium would have 12 electrons, right? That's how it works. So you've got an equal number of protons and electrons for the stable elements, right? The stable elements go all the way out until you get to the lanthanides and alkanides. Mm-hmm. But the point being that we are just moving through our higher states of awareness, and there's only actually one element going through its periodicity. Starts with one electron and one proton, and then it just adds electrons and protons until it becomes unstable. And there's in total 137 elements, of which we've discovered 118. There's still 19 other elements we haven't discovered. And some of them are actually prior to hydrogen.
Really?
They're called hydrinos. Yeah. So if you look at it, the number of elements on the periodic elements table is, you know, you've got hydrogen, which is the peak of a wave. The whole structure of how we looked at this as a table doesn't really make sense because that's not the way nature does it. It mm-hmm. would be a spiral or something. Mm-hmm. And so you look at the next octave, which would then go from hydrogen. The next element is helium, mm-hmm. right? Then you've got lithium. They've got three electrons, three protons. Then after lithium, you've got beryllium. Then beryllium goes to boron, right? So boron has five electrons. And then you've got six electrons, which is carbon. So it makes a cube. Wait a minute, this is genius. How the heck did the ancient polymaths know, like Plato, that carbon and earth was a cube that would have six electrons, six protons, and six neutrons? What's the sum of angles of a cube?
Well,
2,160 degrees. And if I took each side, right, of the six sides of a cube, right?
Right.
It comes out to the exact same math. It's the exact same math.
So is it possible?
Six electrons, six protons.
So this is a hypothesis. Is it possible that some of the great minds of our past, quote
yes.
unquote past, Galileo, Plato, Socrates, all of them, just lay them out, were at a different vibrational frequency and level in their journey to raise their consciousness? Some of them were, even if you were like one or two steps above everybody else, you were so far beyond everybody else that you would look like a genius. It would be the equivalent of you or I walking into a place that, a tribe that's never seen a man, and all of a sudden we are absolutely at a whole other level intellectually. But this is on a spiritual level, even yes. though they might have not even known.
So this is the great secret. It's yeah. the great secret. The great yeah. secret is, and why Sri Yukteswar named his book Holy Science, uh-huh. because in order to go to higher states of knowledge, the doorway must be through raising your vibration, which must come through higher spirituality.
And yet the science, that the hard science or the materialism of today,
it works in exactly the opposite direction. Way. So everybody that discovered things, so you look at mathematicians through time who discovered things, whether it's Plato who came up with the Platonic solids, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe it was someone else at the Egyptian mystery schools who didn't want to be named because basically they could be killed also, mm-hmm. right?
Not Galileo. Of
like
course,
Galileo, yeah. Yeah. right? Or, you know, Giordano Bruno, mm-hmm. burned at the stake type of thing, mm-hmm. right? So every time you had this massive expansion in human awareness, it always came through a spiritual doorway.
Always.
Always. Da Vinci, right? He was a spiritualist, without a doubt.
Einstein.
Einstein also, right? And then everybody wants to take the spiritual aspect out of the equation and just say, no, it's just about the science. If you just focus on the science, you will never discover anything. You'll never discover anything. You'll only push things around the table and the paper. You're not actually going to move the needle in science. Mathematics will only come. Whenever we go to a higher dimension, we have to first get a download of the new source code mm-hmm. for that higher dimension of consciousness.
Robert, I could talk to you for another 4 hours.
Likewise, my friend.
It has been such a pleasure and honor talking to you, my friend. We'll have to do it again.
Absolutely.
Invitation. Anytime you want to come down to the studios.
Okay. Next time I'm here, I'll let you know.
But I appreciate you, my friend. Thank you again for everything you're doing to awaken the planet as well.
Thank you. Love you, man.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey. And don't forget to subscribe.